Well, welcome to FIA Boca 2021, and I am thrilled to introduce someone who needs no introduction, ICE's Jeff Sprecher. Jeff is founder, chairman, and CEO of Intercontinental Exchange, as well as chairman of the New York Stock Exchange. Jeff, welcome to FIA Boca 2021.
Thank you, Walt. It's nice to be here, at least virtually, with you.
Well, I know we're not in Boca, but at least we are sort of dressed for Boca. I mean, this is the standard fare for Boca, so we appreciate you being here. And I wanted to start with today with a question about our markets. You know, as you're looking at so many difficult and uncertainties that we're facing as a society with COVID, we have lots of political unrest and situations happening right now. As you look at the markets right now, what are you focusing on as one of the more difficult challenges that our markets are facing today?
Well, I think, you know, the immediate focus obviously is getting through the COVID pandemic. And I say that in the hopes that we get, that there is an end, or at least a new normal that that will allow economies to function fully again. But longer term, I really think that that central bank policy is having a big impact on markets. It actually started more than a decade ago with the global financial crisis, and has somewhat continued now for more than a decade of activist central bank policy, pumping liquidity into the system, trying to keep interest rates low, and it's going to, you know, be the markets are going to determine the long-term impact of that. And I think, to me, it will have an impact.
And what do you see as the potential impact? Is that bubbles, asset bubbles that we see? Is it inflation? What are you most worried about?
It's the thing that you don't know, it's the black swan. Obviously, low interest rates has created a lot of wealth for people and corporations that have access to credit, and to a certain degree have really raised everybody, at least pre-COVID, in the sense that the corporations were expanding and hiring and employment globally was falling to historic lows. But you have to ask yourself, are we going to pay the piper for that? And now you're really in very uncertain times with COVID and central bank policy. As a result, we've seen the rise of an alternative currency, or maybe currencies, in digital assets. I think that's correlated. We've seen the retailization of markets. I think that's correlated. So, but I think it's all at the root of it is liberal central bank policies around the world.
Well, let's turn to Europe. You have quite a presence in Europe with exchange and clearing infrastructure already, mostly in the UK, but you have some in continental Europe as well. So, now that Brexit, January, Brexit is on us and we are in the midst of the transition, how do you see this playing out? Is this relationship stabilized at this point, or how do you see this playing out for your infrastructure and your exchange?
There's a tension in Europe between politicians and regulators about location of markets and oversight of markets and cooperation in the oversight of markets that really is at the root of what we're dealing with. I would just say to you, the one thing I know as a manager in a market is that the markets are more flexible and smarter than the managers, than the politicians and the regulators. The markets will determine their ultimate location. They will determine their ultimate form in a very powerful, global capital formation mechanism. And so you know, I do worry about the short term nature of how Brexit gets resolved, and hopefully Europe and the UK and the US and various important Asian regulators will find a common standard. But if they don't, the markets are going to figure out where they want to reside and how they want to operate, regardless of those regulators. And you know, we constantly chase our tail as overseers of markets, because you have to acknowledge that that the wisdom of the crowd and the formation of capital is incredibly powerful.
Well, we've talked about some of the challenges facing markets, but there are also opportunities. And I know you're always thinking about, for your shareholders, how to grow ICE and its company and your company. So what areas of growth are you looking at right now that intrigue you and that you're focused on?
Probably the biggest initiative in our company right now is essentially creating an exchange, if you will, for the U.S. mortgage industry. If you look at all the parts that we've assembled and what we're building, it looks like we're building networks for the mortgage industry, but in the vernacular of the people that are at this audience, we're just building an infrastructure to match a buyer and a seller and then figure out how to close and settle. And basically a clearing settlement infrastructure for the U.S. mortgage industry. And the domain knowledge that we have coming out of operating commodity exchanges and equity exchanges, it's very, very similar. It's been a, you know, intellectually intriguing project for us. And we've had a lot of early success in essentially what is an analog to digital conversion around U.S. mortgage, similar to what, you know, many of us that have been in the commodities area have witnessed in the digitization of trading. One other thing we're working on is our affiliate called Bakkt, which we set up as a separate brand, separate company with a separate brand, that with the idea that it would ultimately become more consumer oriented and have a different feel and footprint than the traditional Intercontinental Exchange. And so we're in the process of taking that company public via a SPAC vehicle on the New York Stock Exchange ultimately. And that's been interesting and exciting because we work so hard at the New York Stock Exchange to help build the infrastructure for this capital formation vehicle called a SPAC. So it's nice to have worked on, you know, developing and promulgating the SPAC infrastructure, and then to actually be able to use one ourselves for the benefit of our shareholders has been rewarding.
I actually saw your announcement on CNBC the day that that was put out. So that's exciting, both, like you said, from the Bakkt initiative, but also the clever use of a SPAC in order to get capital to that initiative. So that's very exciting. I did want to turn to your chairman of the New York Stock Exchange and Stacey Cunningham is the CEO there. You know, recently with the retail phenomenon around Robinhood and the Reddit chat rooms and the price of GameStop, you know, increasing significantly, you know, people have been thinking about the implications of the rise of the retail trader, especially when they're acting in concert around certain assets. They haven't really been successful in our markets yet. But how are you thinking about this phenomena from a 100,000 foot standpoint? And what should we be thinking about from a regulatory standpoint and how we approach it?
Yeah, there's sort of two major themes that I think I have come out of this. One is you're definitely seeing the democratization of markets. You know, the ability when you digitize a market and you make it available on a mobile device or via a mouse click or through a simple algorithm that you can create on a spreadsheet, you've really democratized trading. And the U.S. equity markets are, from a time scale, further ahead, have been doing it longer than the commodity markets. And so you know, we may see essentially more democratization, retail trading of commodities over time. In other words, this equity event may be foreshadowing what we may see in other markets. But, and that's a good thing. I mean, to increase access and give everybody access to information is good for markets. And the flip side is that the regulatory structure of the U.S. equity markets, in my mind, is flawed. It is a culmination of regulators that were trying to create competition in markets, and they viewed the competition as being competition between brokers and exchanges, and not the competition that I believe should exist, which is the competition between the buyer and the seller to get the best price for each party. That's the natural market competition, and the exchanges and brokers and clearing firms and settlement issues are part of the infrastructure that a free market will sort out, in my mind. And so I think the recent GameStop event has pointed out some of the inherent flaws in the U.S. equity market structure, and I'm hoping that in the future regulators will roll back some of the punitive rules and allow the market itself to deal with the intermediary structure, and the competition between buyer and seller will find natural homes for that liquidity to reside, in my mind.
Let's turn to Asia. You know, one of the topics under consideration is the opening of China and its markets. They continue to list more products that foreign investors or futures exchanges can now invest in. There's lots of Stock Connect links that link mainland China to the outside world. But how is your company approaching the opening of China, and what opportunities might exist for ICE?
I think the short answer is we don't know how to approach it right now. On the one hand, linking our capital markets, allowing capital to be raised by China in the U.S. brings that capital flow under the vision and auspices of U.S. politicians and regulators. It gives the U.S. more influence, but on the other hand, it allows U.S. capital to go in and help China build. And so the other alternative is we don't allow U.S. capital to go in, other foreign capital goes in, and the U.S. doesn't have any influence. And I don't know what the right balance of that is right now, because our relationship with China is so fluid, and I wouldn't want to bet on to be on the wrong side of that bet. Honestly, I think you know, and it's a bigger issue than a manager in a business can sort out. This is really our two societies, and represented by two governments, are going to have to determine: are we going to work together, or are we going to, you know, be frenemies, or are we going to ignore each other and have a bit of a cold war? And you know, it's a major issue, and I don't have the answer for it. So as a manager, we're looking for guidance and leadership from our government, and we're looking for you know, we want to be in communication and understand as much as we can the views of the China business community and its government, so that we could make rational, informed decisions, which right now, you know, it doesn't seem to be the case. I would just say at the New York Stock Exchange, we have a obligation to be non-discriminatory. We do not have the ability to turn down a lawful company that has SEC approval to do an IPO. you know, we can't cherry pick who we want to do business with. We are essentially a regulated utility, and right now, you know, those capital markets are open for many Chinese companies, and with more limitations, at least at the end of the Trump administration, on Chinese companies that have strong government affiliations. And that's kind of where we are right now, but the Biden administration hasn't yet opined on its view on that. And we have to take our guidance from them, because we you know, I've read articles that say that we should be doing X, Y, or Z, and the reality is we're regulated and are non-discriminatory at this point.
Let's get back to cryptocurrencies, and you talked about the BACT initiative and its growth through a SPAC vehicle. So we have Bitcoin near record high prices. Is Bitcoin finally sort of institutionalizing and coming into the mainstream, in your view? And what's missing from the regulatory or market framework in order for Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies really to take off?
Yeah, it certainly has become more institutionalized than it has in the past, but it is not yet a part of the U.S. or Western banking system. Bank regulators have not really allowed regulated bank-type entities to participate in those markets. So what you see is an OTC market, and not what we know at the FIA as a regulated futures market for the actual coin itself. CME and some others have derivative products, cash settled against an index. But the actual use of physical Bitcoin, we have a physically settled future. And if you look at who the FCMs are, they're largely non-bank FCMs. And because, as you know, the remedy, if there's a default in a clearinghouse, is to grab the customer's position and liquidate it. But at a moment in time, there's a custody of that customer position that would potentially go into the banking system. And so that's still very fuzzy. And it's not clear. Government hasn't really come to a conclusion yet on whether they're going to embrace this or not embrace it. They've sort of ignored it, and in a certain extent, I think consciously ignored it, and allowed it to flourish to what it is today. But it's very unclear whether the major central banks of the world want to allow a non-central bank controlled currency to exist. I believe that we will have digital dollars and digital pounds and euros. Whether or not those essentially are in the form of Bitcoin or Ether or some other fungible digital token that is not central bank controlled is in my mind yet to be seen. That's the risk return, I think, that exists in that market.
Well, I've heard you describe ICE as much of a technology company as a marketplace in the past. And I know you are investing significant dollars all the time into the infrastructure of ICE. From a technology standpoint, where do you see the greatest need, both for ICE, but for the industry, on where we need to be spending dollars on technology?
Well, as a community, we basically will rise and fall together. And as you've seen from the GameStop trading episode, and as we're recording this video today, the DTCC has announced that they can have a white paper out where they can speed up the settlement times potentially in the U.S. equities market. And I haven't read that white paper, but I know it exists. But they won't be able to do that without the entire industry moving its own internal systems to be able to accommodate. So as an industry, you know, we're in a evolution, not a revolution, a digital evolution. And you know, speed, and it's not just the speed of news and information, but the reaction to it now is getting faster and faster and faster. And what you see as an industry is we need to continue to constantly improve and evolve our back office risk systems. And again, as we're filming this, we just went through a massive cold spell in Texas that impacted the electrical and natural gas infrastructure there. And my company, as the largest global energy exchange, you know, was dealing with contracts that were impacted there, and having to navigate the risks, real-time risk systems of you know, highly volatile pricing. My company systems and all of the counterparties that we talked to, we were able to navigate that, including the fact that there was a President's Day holiday on Monday. So the bank systems basically being closed, even though obviously the electrical grid and weather was impacting Texas on that day. So we were able to navigate that. But, you know, I'm sure there'll be lessons learned and constant investment still in that back office settlement infrastructure to keep up with the real-time nature of the markets that we're managing.
Let's talk a little bit about sustainability. In 2010, ICE bought the Chicago Climate Exchange, and now your company runs much of the carbon trading infrastructure around the globe. I think you're running the European carbon trading scheme. The UK is about to launch its carbon trading scheme as well as the Northeast United States REGI system. So as you look at the rise of ESG products and the need for more sustainable carbon offsets as we enter in the United States or re-enter the Paris Accord, what do you think the opportunities are for our markets and ICE in particular?
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say, first of all, that these carbon-based and renewable-oriented energy products that we list are some of the fastest-growing contracts that we trade. And so I think that alone, you know, will attract capital and interest in those markets. I'm a strong believer, and maybe you've gleaned it from my earlier answer, that markets are powerful. They're more powerful than the decisions that we make as regulators and politicians and managers. And so, you know, you've seen a velocity increase in capital going into that area of the market, and which is, you know, I think probably a good thing for the planet. Similarly, we just launched a product to bring climate information and attach it to municipal bond valuations. In other words, as an investor is thinking about essentially loaning money to a project, a municipal project, what are the climate implications of that? You know, is it positive or negative? And do you want to take that into consideration? This came out of essentially the fires that were rampant in California that damaged a lot of infrastructure. And if you were an investor in that infrastructure, you know, would you have wanted to know, or did you even think about the fact that your investment, you know, might be subject to potential fire damage? And so you see investment decisions now increasingly taking environmental factors into play, and we as a data provider are you know, gathering a lot of that information. We're not opining on whether or not you should take it into effect, or you know, what the factors you should think about are. But we do believe that the information, fact-based information, should be made available to you, so that if you want to filter that in to your thought process that it's available to you. And that's been a very big growth area for us because of a lot of investors are saying, I would like to, as much information as I can about, you know, my target investment, including environmental information.
Well, Jeff, we so appreciate you being part of the FIA BOCA 2021 program, and you're such an important voice for our community. But thank you so much for being here, and we hope to see you in person soon.
Yeah, I hope, you know, I put on a lightweight, you know, jacket like I would wear in Florida. So I'm hoping that next year that, you know, you can see me wear this in person and we can all be together in Florida, because that's an important event for our community. And, you know, all of us are trying to stay in touch with one another via video. But there's just something about bumping into people in the hallway and having quick conversations and being able to, you know, have some collegiality amongst our community, even though many of us compete, that's hard to replicate on video. So I do hope that we're back together soon and that you have an opportunity to put that fantastic event on.